It's Hugh Hewitt. 2020 is upon us. Thank you for listening. First live broadcast of the new decade. And therefore, I'm spending a lot of time with guests like last hour, Admiral James Stavridis, next hour, Major General Mel Spies, this hour, Lieutenant General David Deptula, retired from the United States Air Force. He leads the Mitchell Institute for Aerospace Studies. Good morning, General. Great to have you with me.
Hey, happy New Year, Hugh. How are you doing today?
I am great. One of my New Year's resolutions, though, is to try and fill the gap in American media, which I think is there. I'll ask whether you agree with me. No one ever we cover breaking news here, as do most of the cable news channels and the other radio stations, but very few people talk even briefly about grand strategy and great power competition. And I think that's a gap that is hurting our public. Do you agree that there is that gap?
Absolutely. In a variety of different perspectives. First, the one that you mentioned right up top, and that's the general public's disinterest in grand strategy. The second one, quite frankly, Hugh, when you think about it, the United States changes its governance every 4 years, at best every 8 years. So one has to question just what is the viability of the United States to be able to form and maintain a grand strategy. Now, we could go on and talk for this for many hours, but it is a point of interest and importance that you raise that perhaps we need to spend a little bit more time thinking about.
Now, what does the Mitchell Institute do? Because I'm trying to explain to everyone why I've selected my roster of recurring guests. You're on it, and thank you for being that, to talk about these issues. And I think it's because of your leadership in the Mitchell Institute, as well as, I mean, your very distinguished career in the Air Force. But this Mitchell Institute is doing what we need to have done.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to chat just a little bit about Mitchell Institute. Basically, we have three major objectives. The first one is to educate the American public on the virtues and values of aerospace power and the options that that particular set of capabilities brings to our nation's leadership, which gets right to the heart of your question in the context of grand strategy. Look, the nation's military possesses four, now five, principal services that focus on being able to dominate operations on land, at sea, in the air, now in space, and in the littorals. So part of the reason that we exist is to talk about the options that dominating air and space bring to our nation's leadership.
All right. Now, General, we got a person driving to work in Pittsburgh. They're a Steelers fan. They don't get out much. They don't read much. Explain to them what grand strategy is, and then segue, if you want, into what great power competition is. More importantly, why should they care?
Well, they should care because it's fundamental. Of grand strategy is the a blueprint, if you will, for the nation's security and the areas and interests around the world that we should be focused on as a nation to protect that worker's interest, to assure that he or she can maintain their freedoms and their way of life without being threatened by adversaries or potential adversaries around the world. Now, how that shifts into great power competition is, I think, most everyone still recalls the Cold War competition between the United States and Russia. That tended to ebb when the Berlin Wall came down, and everyone was looking forward to a period of peaceful prosperity that the Russians would engage in that post-early 90 time frame. Well, it didn't turn out that way. So we now have very aggressive competitors, both in the context of Russia under its dictator Putin, as well as a very strongly growing and emergent China, both economically, most people are aware of that, but also militarily. So we are now entering an era of renewed great power competition where our grand strategy is most appropriate, and the context is of we need to lay out about on a longer-term basis, not just what's going to happen tomorrow, but what's going to happen in 10, 15, 20 years, and how we want the situation in terms of U.S. security interest to grow and also facilitate our peace and prosperity. Now, I know it's a lot of words, but there you go.
Well, I was listening yesterday to Peter Thiel, the high-tech visionaries book from Zero to One. In it, he said, if you were born from 1945 to 1965, your life got better every year, and you didn't even know why. It just did, because America was growing at such an extraordinary rate, and although there was a Soviet Union, it did not interfere with our great power status, and we won that competition. He believes it's dangerous to take that for granted, but that the boomers do. It all depends on whether or not our country harnesses its abilities to remain on top, and I don't know that we think much about that.
Well, Hugh, that's why studying and understanding history is so vitally important. And one of the first elements of U.S. grand strategy should be to assure that it has an educated and well-informed public, which takes us right into education and what we're teaching our young people about the past. Because if you don't learn the past, obviously, as Santana said, you're bound to repeat it, or it's, others have said, at least the future is going to rhyme with what's happened in the past. So if you don't understand it, we've got some real, real challenges ahead. And frankly, you see some of that in some of the discourse that is emerging during this political season.
In his 7-page end-of-the-year annual report on the courts, Chief Justice Roberts appealed for a reinvigoration of civics education. That's not quite what I'm about here. I'm appealing to people who've already got the civics down but are trying to figure out the grand strategy. But I genuinely do fault higher education, even elementary and secondary education, for failing to teach the world as it is, as opposed to our grievance culture, our intersectionality culture. I just want to begin with basic facts on the ground, and those are, I think, what you cover. There are bad people in the world, and they want to do bad things.
Absolutely. And again, I reiterate, history is so important in that regard. I mean, to you and I, or at least to me anyway, you know, the first Gulf War seemed like it just happened yesterday, but in context, you know, that was 1991. We're talking 29 years ago, and that's like ancient history to many folks. You know, what were the characteristics? What were the ways that allowed us to dominate what arguably was the last major regional conflict that we had? Those are the kinds of elements that we ought to be thinking about as we craft our strategies as we move into the future. But so, you can't do that if you don't understand the past.
So let me ask to tie it up in a bow for today.
Yeah.
We had an assault on our embassy in Iraq 2 days ago. It's over today, although Secretary Pompeo canceled his trip. The National Security Advisor is going back to D.C. Everyone's gathering there. It's not. It's a crisis, but it's simmering now. How does that fit into a grand strategy? I mean, what do you ask? What questions do you ask after that kind of a show of force by Iran on the streets of Baghdad?
Well, again, the way it fits into it is a tactical level action, but it fits into a larger context in the terms of what the United States policy toward Iran and Iraq needs to be. I would tell you that the embassy attack, and I'm glad that you painted it that way, it certainly was not a set of protesters. The people that did this were militants of the Hezbollah brigades that are an Iraqi Shia paramilitary group. But the bottom line is that attack and our response present a stark choice for Iraq's leaders about their country's future. Namely, are they going to opt for international isolationism akin to Iran's, or the type of sovereign functional state that the legitimate Iraqi protesters have been asking and dying for since October 1st. Now, with respect to the United States, we face our own quandary. While the air attacks against the Hezbollah brigades were certainly necessary, carrying those out without taking other larger, long-term policy measures could give Iraqi political elites an excuse to keep delaying the crucial reforms that their nation needs to accomplish. So grand strategy is very important. We've had a strategy over the last 20 years or so in Iraq that has been wandering, not one that is focused on what are the U.S. critical interests and how should we respond. And that's the kind of long-term thinking and strategy that needs to be going on at the National Security Council today.
Now, General, if I'm not mistaken, you spent a lot of time in airplanes over that region of the world. And we ran an air program from the first Gulf War to the second Gulf War to suppress Saddam's malignant activities in the region. So you know what it's like to target and to be fired upon there. What is our capacity to find, isolate, and attack the Hezbollah cadres like we did last week?
Well, I tell you that it's much better today than it was 20 years ago or 29 years ago when we initiated the first. We didn't initiate, but when we concluded the aggression and halted the aggression from Saddam, we have an extraordinary set of capabilities to be able to target the Hezbollah brigades and other Iranian-supported militias in the region due to some extensive intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets, as well as working together with indigenous friends on the ground. You know, there's some dedicated people inside Iraq that want to see their nation grow into a viable sovereign state. The problem is it's been infected by the Iranians to a degree that we've never seen before, and that's why you see the legitimate Iraqi protesters that have been suppressed, quite frankly, and allowed to be suppressed by Iranian military commanders. And that's what needs to be taken care of in terms of the governance in Iraq.
1 minute, General Deptula. Do you think we are headed inevitably into a force-on-force contact with Iranian regulars? Because it does seem like the Quds force uses all these proxies, but the real problem is Soleimani and Khamenei.
That's a difficult question to answer, because I certainly hope not. However, in order to avoid that kind of conflict, we need to be prepared to meet the Iranians with the full might of the force of the United States of America. And once they understand that if, in fact, they elect to go down that road, they'll be crushed like a bug, then it's that kind of deterrent capability that will prevent the conflict that we don't want to see, but one that we can't be afraid to initiate if, in fact, that will result in greater stability and safety for the United States.
Lieutenant General David Deptula, Dean of the Mitchell Institute for Aerospace Studies, thank you. Look forward to many conversations in 2020, General. Thank you.
Okay, Hugh. Bye-bye.